barrel roll.
Welcome to The Know, I'm Ashley Jenkins. After rumors surfaced this week that Zelda would miss Nintendo Switch's launch in March 2017, but might be replaced by Mario at the last minute, we seemingly have some confirmation, admittedly unofficial, via a report from Let's Play Video Games. Editor-in-chief Laura Dale writes that Mario won't be the only launch title for Switch, however, because it will be joined by both Skyrim and a port for Splatoon on day one, with Splatoon being a pack-in for more expensive bundles of the system. As for Mario, the plumber's new title will feature a 3D open-world hub where you can select different stages. Oh, it sounds just like Mario 64, I'm so excited. The upcoming Mario will also feature co-op play, with both players helping each other complete objectives, with a little bit of competition mixed in for who contributes the most to finishing each level. No word on the title yet, but Let's Play Video Games reports that Nintendo is readying a demo for the press to experience for the next big Switch event in January. By the time January rolls around, we weren't supposed to have much longer to wait for Persona 5 to drop in North America and Europe, but now that's all out the window because it's been delayed again, this time from Valentine's Day to April 2017. Talk about breaking some hearts. Atlas made the announcement on a Persona livestream yesterday, attributing the delay to needing more time to refine the English audio. A spokesperson from Atlas added, I know, it stings. But Persona 5 set the gold standard for Atlas with its launch in Japan, and we wanted to put the utmost care into ensuring it winds up the best when it launches in the West. They also said players will have the option to switch between the new English audio and the original Japanese audio with subtitles. Just give us the second one, that's all we need, we're cool, patch it in later, that's what everyone's doing these days. Ubisoft may not have had time to get Watch Dogs 2's multiplayer working right ahead of launch. See, they're one of those guys, just really patches later. But that also may probably, in Watch Dogs' case, be because they were spending so much time making sure everyone had some fully rendered next-gen genitals. Players discovered this week that the hacker game is chock full of dongles and ports, leading to unfortunate PSN bans for any gamers who shared images of the genitalia via PS4 share. This is the world we live in. Ubisoft has since apologized for the anatomical oversight, if you can call it that, considering they had to model them, saying it will patch out the famous hoo-ha that players have been screenshotting all week long. Apparently, the dicks are gonna stay though, so you can keep making your Watch Dogs jokes for as long as you want. So far, Respawn Entertainment has walked the company line when it comes to commenting about Titanfall 2's not very ideal release date, but being sandwiched between Battlefield 1 and Infinite Warfare might be starting to get to CEO Vince Zampella, who had some choice comments about EA's strategy in a recent interview. Speaking with Gixel about the timing of the game's launch, Zampella said, "It's always a concern, that's what I'll say, especially when you have two games on top of each other." When pressed a little bit more if there would be a Titanfall 3 after Titanfall 2's allegedly lackluster sales as a result of that date, Zampella said, "They don't know yet," but then asked an EA representative in the room if they could say more. The representative replied, "What we've said is we're committed to the franchise," to which Zampella added, "So whatever the fuck that means." Man, that sounds kind of awkward. You certainly have to feel for Respawn though. They released a very well-reviewed game up against the two biggest franchises of the year. Hopefully, their franchise doesn't get punished as a result. I guess we'll see when the over long-term sales. 2K and Gearbox's Battleborn, that was another one that suffered from a near release date with Overwatch, has been one of the gaming industry's favorite punching bags since it went head-to-head with Blizzard's biggest new launch earlier this year and lost big time. And now the game has hit an abysmal new low just months after its launch. If you're in the mood for some sad stats, a user on NeoGAF grabbed a screenshot of Battleborn's player numbers showing that at peak, it's only pulling in around 250 players per day, and at its low point, just below 90. The player base is so diminished that Battleborn's most hardcore fans tried to throw a revival weekend for the game in order to stir up more interest and bring players back into the fold, and at most, that only brought in around 700 players. It probably doesn't help that the game is still a baffling $60 price point on Steam, despite months of speculation that it should maybe just get it over with and go free to play. Although, then again, that didn't work out great for Evolve in the long run. It's a tale as old as time, but that didn't stop Beauty and the Beast from setting some really pretty insane online records earlier this week. Yes, Beauty and the Beast, setting online records. The new live-action remake of the animated classic debuted its trailer to huge numbers, with more than 127 million views globally in its first 24 hours. That beats the previous record holders, Star Wars The Force Awakens, which had 112 million views day one, and 50 Shades Darker, which they're still making, I guess, with 114 million views. I mean, never discount the Disney fans, guys. There was certainly a ton of buzz about the movie online, thanks in part to star Emma Watson and also the film's devotion to the 1991 fan favorite animated film. You can already find tons of breakdowns of the trailer, comparing screens from the original to the remake, so basically, the world loves Disney princesses way more than they love lightsabers and watching people diddle each other, which, I mean, I guess that's the way, I guess that's a good thing, but what fun is it? The US government says electric cars can no longer be silent and deadly. The US National Highway Traffic Safety Administration set out some new rules for electric and hybrid car manufacturers, now requiring those cars to make an audible noise when moving below speeds of 19 miles per hour. It sounds crazy, but it's actually pretty reasonable. The idea is that this will better alert pedestrians or the visually impaired when a slow-moving car is creeping up on them ninja style. Because pedestrians are used to that noise. Have an electric car, the number of people who've walked out in front of it without looking because they don't hear anything is too damn high. There aren't any actual requirements at the moment on what type of sounds the cars need to make, so who knows, maybe someone out there will just do something really fun with it. But don't breathe a sigh of relief too quickly, because these rules aren't even going to be enforceable until September 2019. So you got plenty of time to get hurt while playing Pokemon Go on busy streets. Do it while you can. Congratulations, seems to be in order for YouTube personality and streamer Markiplier. Round of applause, who just scored a big signing deal with world-renowned talent agency WME. For those who don't know, WME represents huge A-listers in the entertainment industry like Ben Affleck, Christian Bale, Amy Adams, Denzel Washington, J.J. Abrams, Quentin Tarantino, the Foo Fighters. Markiplier, aka Mark Fishbox, said he made the decision because he wants to get into more traditional media like acting and music. So who knows, maybe you'll one day see Markiplier grace the big screen. But hopefully he'll still find plenty of time to keep doing those Let's Plays we love him for. Come on, keep the crazy hair. You know it's getting close to the end of the year when we start hearing about the annual Game Awards show, an event that really doesn't mean much of anything, but gives us a reason to argue about video games, which is the only thing we love more than actually playing them. All the nominees for the 2016 show have been revealed, with Doom, Inside, Overwatch, and Uncharted 4 all up for Game of the Year. Uncharted 4 leads the pack with 8 nominations in total, while Firewatch, Inside, and Overwatch tie for second with 5 nominations each. Out of the publishers, Sony leads with 13 nominations, while Microsoft Studios only has 4, which makes things a little bit awkward, seeing as how the show is at the Microsoft Theater in Los Angeles. There are, of course, some notable absences, like Rise of the Tomb Raider and No Man's Sky, which I'm sure we all thought was gonna be on there. Kidding on the last one. But overall, 63 games are eligible for rewards in categories like Best Game Direction, Best Art Direction, Best Narrative, Best Performance, Best Indie, Best VR, Best Action, Best Multiplayer, and Best Trending Gamer, including Friends of the Know, Boogie2988, and Danny O'Dwyer, who can they both win? That'd be great. You can find out who among your favorites will take home the most prizes when the Game Awards air live on December 1st. So, that about does it for today's roundup. Let us know what you think about all these stories in the comments below. And as always, for more news from every corner of the internet, like this video and subscribe to The Know.
I'm really happy that Eddy actually used my watchdogs kill.
Oh my god, watchdogs, holy shit. All the nominees for the 2016 show have finally been revealed, with Doom, Inside, Overwatch, and Unfart. Okay.